Hello and good afternoon, or good morning as the case may be. Today is my day 1.310. It's March 18th and we have 11 days to go till my GCS surgery. Just kind of to put this where it is in time, and I was waiting for the computer to boot or the video program to load, I noticed that my hair has kind of gotten to the point that it's kind of out of shot. You know, I can go back like that, but I can remember when my hair was very, very short. So how's it going? How's it going? A little tired. I'm very, very tired. Lots of stuff going on. As you might imagine, with 11 days to go, I am preparing. I'm at the point now where I need to start to, gather the sheets for my mom's bed while she's here and wash the blanket and get the pillows ready. I mean, we're very, very, very close. This is like the last, the last full week of preparation before we go, you know, and so the little things that you always put off to the last minute, you know, we're getting up to the last minute, you know, which is really good. And today, over the last couple days, my body has really, I'm saying it's rejecting vegetables, but my body, I think, is at the point where it's like, you know, like, only analogy I can think of is when you're in college or even high school and you have a final, you know, more so in college, you have a final for your class. And I've always thought the final was the most stupidest thing in the world. You know, you can be asked any question on anything from day one of the course, you know, so, well, maybe it's not that bad of a thing if you're a brain surgeon. You know, but if you're studying, it's not your major and, you know, you really am just taking the class because you have to get your credits, you know, really it's just a matter of memorization. So you spend 3 or 4 days before leading up to the final and you're just taking in information, taking in information, taking in information. And you reach a point, hopefully you've given enough time to digest this body of knowledge and you have it on hold, you know, in your immediate memory. You reach a point where you're like, okay, I have absorbed as much information as I'm going to do. Yes, I will continue to review, but there's not much more I can cram in there. So at this point, I just need to focus on getting enough sleep, reviewing my notes. And it's like you're ready to go if at a moment's notice if you need to. You've prepared all you can do. And much like when you walk into that final and you have your pen or your paper, your, you know, however you take your final, in 2 hours, 3 hours time, it's going to be over. You're going to be able to walk away knowing you did a good job, the best you could do. And so you resign yourself to it. You give into it and you just accept it. And I guess that's kind of how I feel now. You know, things are going to happen. I just have to continue with my schedule. Later this week will be when we hit 7 days to surgery. I have to stop taking my vitamins. I take fish oil to help with my omega-3 and my healthy cholesterol and everything. I have to stop that. I mean, you know, these are kind of the last things, much like when you have that final and you take your breath and you go, okay, I am prepared. We just have to let it happen. And that's kind of how I feel today. But my body, okay, this is where we started with. My body is just, you know, because I had to lose so much weight, you know, for a good almost a year. It was March 24th, I think, last year when I went up and found I was too heavy to have surgery. And then I needed a good week to poo-poo and pity party myself. But then I'd say by the end of March, I was committed. Should have been committed. No, I was committed to losing the weight. If not March, maybe April. I don't know. I probably was still bitching in May. I don't want to go back. It's negativity. There's no point in revisiting it. But so let's just say 8 months. For the last 8 months, I have been committed to losing weight and maintaining my low weight and everything. And so I have been eating nothing but vegetables, raw vegetables, cooked stewed vegetables, little to no seasoning, no salt, no nothing. And so, imagine eating, the same 10 vegetables just in different ways. And that's been my existence. And I don't mean that as a complaint. It's just that's what my body has gotten used to. And I think my body mentally has kind of reached that, much like the final, okay, I accept it, but I want different things. Maybe it wants to celebrate the final after final before you take it, which is a problem. But so I've noticed over the last, I'd say 3 days, just my body is like my GI tract. No matter what I do, I have a huge amount of gas. I have constipation. It's like I feel like my body is just saying, enough. And of course, my mind is still in control, and my mind says, no, dear friend, you have 11 days, and you are not going to screw this up for me. So the brain is in control of the body. However, the body realizes it can make life difficult. And so there have been times in the last 2 weeks, I'd say, where I've had severe pain in my abdominal system from gas and constipation. And the last 3 days have been really not bend you over to your knees pain, but like I said, I think my body is starting to revolt to it. I won't say my body's revolting, like it's disgusting, but I mean, my body is saying, look, you ain't gonna eat vegetables in a week, actually, in a week, I will be still eating vegetables, but 3 more days after that, like I said, we're up to 11 days, and I know the first day after surgery is probably gonna be liquids and jello and shit, but chicken broth sounds wonderful to me, being in a position where I'm not eating meat. Animal protein. I've not had animal protein in so long. I've not had salt, other than what's naturally in vegetables. I can pick up a tomato or even a carrot and take a bite out of it, and I can taste the natural sweetness or the sugar or the salt that's in it. That's how my taste buds have become acclimated to such a low level of salt or a low level of sugar or naturally occurring sugars and salts. So I had a bite of my daughter's, I think I made her mashed potatoes, and I always add butter and salt and pepper to her mashed potatoes, and I took a bite of it. And I mean, not only was it delicious and what I would normally eat a year ago, but it was so much salt and so much butter. And whatnot. So, cooking wise, when not cooking for myself in the moment, I definitely am a full, what I would consider to be a full-bodied cook. I cook with butter. I use salt. I use pepper. You know what I mean? I mean, I don't use margarine or low fat, I mean, milk and cheese and sour cream. And I mean, no. We go the full, for my daughter, occasionally low fat cheese, but you know what I mean. I mean, we go, if you're, get all the natural nutrients and everything. So, like I said, so that's good. 11 days. And in the meantime, I'm just gassy and constipated, and I'm taking medicine to try and keep me regular or whatnot. But my body, like I said, I mean, my body's starting to put up a little bit of a fight. So that's where I'm at. A little bit of metaphysical thought here, and this will kind of be, this is what, this next topic is kind of what made me want to make the video today, other than just a general status. Excuse me. I have to itch a little bit. My elephant, by the way, is hairless. I'm happy to say, speaking of that area of my body, as it has to be. I have 2 more sessions of electrolysis downstairs, and I'm happy to say the surgical site is ready. Yes, there are the occasional little hairs and whatnot, but it really is just a matter of cleaning up and getting the stragglers, the surviving hairs, the little determined boogers that survive, and then tightening up the lines, which really hurts. And that's what happened to me last week. The tech was, I think, tightening up the perimeter and going into the forest that had never been touched before, let's say, the trees that had never been touched, and it was painful. Areas that have been zapped two or three times, they're not as painful. They're not as sharp as they used to be, because I think they've been damaged by the process, and so the neurons don't fire off right. And I'm not a doctor, but areas that have been done a couple times, let me put you that way. If she does it, it doesn't really hurt. Whereas if she goes into some virgin territory, it hurts. But luckily, only two more sessions of that, so I can tolerate that. So, what is this metaphysical? Why? What drove me to make the video other than a general status update? If you don't know, you probably do know, but I've been taking this last year to explore different religions and paganism and specifically witchcraft. And I am not committing myself to anything for a year, but I am studying this year and learning as much as I can to make an educated, before I commit myself, or I'm not going to say initiate myself, or probably commit myself to a deeper relationship. This is beyond the courting period. This is learning as much as I can. And so my recent I had a wand jump out at me. And so I was like, okay, let me rephrase that. I had an offering of a tree come into my possession. And it was very energetic to me, and I took that as a sign that I needed to learn about wands. And this, in I have come to address it as my learner's permit wand. It's my learner's wand. And a little earlier today, I did consecrate it and purify it, consecrate it, and whatnot. So I'm a little drained from that too. But what got me thinking about it, and here's where we're going to get into the topic of the video, is belief. Okay? If I said to you, I have a magic wand, okay? And let's say you don't believe in magic wands, or you don't believe in magic, or you don't believe in the astral plane, you don't believe in ghosts and fairies and goblins and zombies. I mean, if you don't believe in something, and that's my take on this, is to make it a little so you won't believe in it. That's why I say zombies. Let's leave zombies out of it. But if you don't believe in the paranormal, for example, ghosts or fairies or dryads, okay, then if I say to you, my learner wand over there has the spirit of a dryad in it to help me learn. And if you don't believe in it, then it sounds crazy, doesn't it? It doesn't make any sense to you. And maybe I'm looking at this, I have to look at it from my older perspective of being raised Catholic. And, not, you don't tolerate a witch. You don't believe, witchcraft and things that are against each other. If you don't believe in it, or you're taught to hate it, that God doesn't smile upon it, whatnot, then it kind of takes a little bit of a malicious tone, I think. But again, if you don't believe in it, then it has no power. It has no, again, it can be like a funny thing. Can you believe so and so thinks they're going to control magic with a wand? And it sounds silly, But as a matter of perspective, let's turn the tables on that and look at Catholicism. And again, I can only say Catholicism because I was raised Catholic and went through confirmation and everything else. You know, if you don't necessarily believe that the Eucharist is the body of Christ, or that through the process of the ritual of the Mass, the wine becomes the blood of Christ, you know, if you don't accept that belief, or if someone else doesn't accept that belief, then it's just equally as preposterous, you know, as a magical wand or casting a spell. You know, it just so happens in our contemporary society, we accept it more. You know, someone says, you know, oh, did you go to church? Or, you know, we're doing this at our church. We're having a Bible study. You know, well, excuse me, man. Pardon me. I said my biology was messing with me today. You know, someone who finds solace and power and belief in a Bible study circle or a Bible study session might say poo-poo caca on a coven that does that casts a circle to draw down energy from the moon or to raise energy for a specific cell or whatnot. It's like Obi-Wan said, you know, it's true from a certain point of view. But again, I'm coming back to the idea of belief. It's what you believe in. And as I can only imagine a witch that believes in her own ability and casting a circle, or in her own ability and raising energy or casting a spell, in the same way as a parishioner who might pray. And again, I have to come back to my Catholicism, you know, pray to a certain saint, or you feast of an individual or something. You know, if they believe in it, it's something they believe in. It's true to them. And in the same way, I later on had the ability to, or I encountered, probably would be a better way, of a Pentecostal church who held Catholicism in the same kind of hokiness that someone else might do with witchcraft. You know, that, you know, Catholics are heathens. You know, they worship people, saints and angels, and, you know, they're not following the true faith, the one faith, you know, my faith. And again, so it's a matter of belief. And I guess in a roundabout way, and how this might relate to this channel, or, you know, our journey as transgender, is if someone believes in it, it is true to them. If someone does not believe in it, then it is not true to them. And I would almost go on to say that no amount of education or cajoling or not skullduggery, but, you know, any amount of convincing is going to convince someone. You know, if you, for example, are a trans person and you have a sibling or a parent or a child that doesn't believe in it, you know, and this more so in my experience is me, in my experience when I was in my teens or my early 20s, in trying to tell my parents that I was transgender, you know, and they didn't believe in it, you know. You know, that was in the 90s, and we're definitely in a much more contemporary world today. But no amount of convincing on my part is going to make them change their mind. And unfortunately, if someone has a sibling or a spouse or a parent who is in a religious belief that does not accept or thinks that God has ill favor or ill thoughts towards gay people or homosexuals, same thing, transgender, I don't really think we are going to gain much by trying to appeal to them with some sort of written, you know, well, in this part of the Bible, it says this, and in this part of the Bible, it says that. You know, from their point of view, they've already made up their mind. It's what they believe in, and it holds water. It just so happens that they can flip open their version of the Bible and say, well, on page blah, 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 or this scripture quote or whatnot, it says this, and even though it's contradicted by this in other places, this is what I believe. This is the word of God, and you're not going to change my mind, blah, 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 blah. And so, like I said, it's from where I'm at now, 46 years old, you know, I recognize that, you know, no amount of convincing, you know, you could do research until the cows come home and present this body of knowledge to them from psychologists or religious folk, lay people or whatnot. And if that individual does not believe in it, it's not something they're going to change their mind. We can hope, you not to say you shouldn't try. But I don't know. It struck me today as I was consecrating my wand and I was reading about the astral plane and gathering, you know, if you wanted to imbue the core of your wand with an astral, what do you call it, the ephemera of a mythical creature like a hippogriff or a unicorn or a phoenix, a feather of a phoenix, you know, things that don't exist in the prime material plane, things that are astral, and how to, you know, generate a connection between our plane of existence and the astral plane, and then how do you get something that can exist in our plane into our plane, into some sort of astral dimension. Excuse me. Let me just see who this is. Hold on, I'm going to pause so you don't hear the phone. All right, there we go. We resolved the phone. And I actually remember what I was talking about. So, yay, me. You know, again, if someone didn't believe in that, it's not going to make any sense to them. Another tool that I have am learning to use is the tarot. Okay, and I have my deck here. And again, the other day as I was meditating and asking, you know, what the universe, the divine all, what I needed to know, I got the Eight of Cups. And you know, someone could, and from what I interpreted that to mean was, you know, I needed to turn my back on voice training for a bit, you know. And someone could say, again, if they don't believe in that, then they'd say, how in the hell can you make a big decision on that? Or let's say it was a job, you know, turning your back to get a new job or whatnot. You'd say, well, how in the hell can you do that based off of a card you do randomly from a deck? Well, again, they don't believe in it. It's not true for them. And again, how that applies to us as trans folk, trans women, is if someone doesn't believe in it, like I said, we're not going to, I don't think we're really going to convince them forcibly. Now, I have found that, you know, I live my life as best I can, and a lot of, I'd say a good chunk of people who initially were very skeptical, okay? You know, after a couple years, you know, that skepticism faded away. Now, I won't say they believe in it. However, over time, the more that I have solidified myself in this way, the more real it is, you know. And I think, excuse me again, I'm sorry. And I think that's a problem that we have when we're in our 20s, when we're younger and younger, especially if our parents don't necessarily believe in it. I'm going to turn this a little bit or whatnot. And they say, oh, this is just a phase, or this is, you know, you don't know what you're talking about, blah, blah, blah. We'll get you into counseling. And again, I hate to hear about someone who's, from a religious point of view, using religion as an excuse for hatred and bigotry and whatnot. That's terrible, but it happens. And, you know, again, once we establish ourselves, I think we lend ourselves some credibility. And this may be a more mature way of looking at it, but when we're standing on our own 2 feet, and again, this might have to do a bit with maturity or whatnot, and we are committed to ourselves, and the more that we bring this idea into reality, the more we manifest it, for lack of a better word, the harder it is to challenge that, you know. And yeah, our parents, our siblings, our loved ones, they may not understand, and they may, you know, they may require us to break with it. I think it's the Eight of Wands is a card about, you know, I'm out of here. You know, I can't, I have to make a decision and I'm leaving. But, you know, it's one of those things that, again, the older we get, the more financially stable. And it's, and after a period of time, it's no longer a phase. You know, this is a lifestyle. This is a choice for the rest of our lives, or at least for a period of our lives, if we like it. You know, there's nothing to say that we can't transition and say, you know, this isn't for me, but at least I've tried it and I have that knowledge. You know, to say, okay, I'm going to have to find a compromise or something else. Or if you're like me, you say to hell with it and never look back. But I've been fortunate in that way, even though I had to detransition in the 90s. But that's a whole other story. So I'll leave you with this other thought, which will kind of close off my ramble here. There was a comic book by Neil Gaiman, who at the time was famous for Sandman. I know he's done Coraline and a bunch of other things. American Gods, I think, is another one. But it's the book's Magic, and it's about a young magician named Tim Hunter, Timothy, and he is being introduced to magic, and magic with a K. But he comes across one of my heroes, John Constantine, another comic book character, and they're driving with someone, and I think it's a cabbie, and the cabbie doesn't believe in magic. And Timothy asks Constantine, you know, well, I don't understand, how can he ignore what's right in front of his face? You know, how can he ignore, use these pliers as an example, say this is a magical tool or something magical. To us, it's real, right? It's a real tool. It has purpose, and we can see it. We can identify it. But for that cabbie, he didn't believe in it. And John said to Timothy, to Tim, he said, but to him, he can't see it. He can't use it because he doesn't believe in it. It's not real to him. Therefore, in his reality, the bus, the cabbie, in his reality, there is no magic. Okay, as in you might... If you were an atheist or an agnostic, but an atheist, and you didn't believe in religion, there is no religion. There is no magic. There is no power there. And so, like I said, I think as it relates to being transgender, is if we have someone in our lives, and it might be, like I said, a parent or a spouse or a loved one or a sibling, a coworker, and they don't believe in it, I don't think we're really going to convince them. Now, that said, I realize that's quite a blanket statement. Definitely, at our workplace, human resources, if you work at a company that has a human resources department and it's worth its weight and its salt, as it were, they're going to have some sort of inclusion and diversity, especially in a corporation like where we're at today, 2018. I know my company has a whole office related to inclusion and diversity that deals with minorities, whether they be ethnical, belief, religious. You know, it's a way of inclusion and diversity is what it is. And, you know, education. And that can be somewhat of a, you know, okay, well, I may not believe as you do, but I will tolerate you, or the famous quote is, I may not believe what you do, but I will fight for your right to believe it. You know, again, that idea of inclusion and diversity in the workplace. Thank goodness we have those protections now. But So yeah, I guess through some education, you might open up someone's mind a little bit. As the saying goes, our minds are like umbrellas. They work best when open. But again, if someone doesn't believe in it, then I think maybe at some point we have to be like the six, eight of cups, no, eight of wands, and get on our, say, okay, I'm out of here. I can't, But, and how does that come up? Why does it come up? I got a card from a parent who is having a hard time with me. And, it takes a lot of effort these days to write a card, okay? To put a card in the mail, address it, put a stamp on it, and send it to somebody. Well, this was for a holiday for St. Patrick's Day. And when the card arrived, it was written to my dead name, And so I was happy because of the effort it took to do that, to think about someone. It's a physical manifestation of that care or thought. But then for it to be addressed to a dead name, it shows how much they don't believe in what I'm doing. You know what I mean? And that's, like I said, where it comes back to the, if it's not real for them, there's nothing we really can do, And as far as here on the prime material plane, if you will, our world, I am projecting myself as a female. I'm projecting myself with feminine energy. I definitely identify more. And here we are 11 days away from having, gender assertion surgery, gender conforming surgery, gender affirming surgery. Okay, for the last 2 years, I have done everything I needed to make my reality more aligned with who and what I am, And my job has no problem with it. My friends, some of my family, But again, it is reality because it's what I believe in. But in the other person's reality, it's not what they believe in. You see the difference there? And again, maybe it's a bit of maturity. And there would have been a time in my point in my life where I would have been angry or upset. I would have taken it as a malicious thing. They're trying to make me change my mind, or they're trying to hurt me, or whatnot. Where I am here at 46 years old is to say, okay, you may not believe in it, and so it's not real to you. But if we're going to interact, one of those things. I don't know. I don't know. I don't know. I think it would be funny, and then I'll end on this thought. None of us knows what the future holds. Even divination such as tarot or runes or whatnot. I mean, it's a potential. It's a possible future. Okay. It's a look at patterns, more appropriately, patterns, what might repeat. But I just have this funny vision of maybe one day in the future getting married again. And it's I think a dream of most of us that to get married. I'm not going to say in a church, but I want the experience, okay? I want the dress and everything. Well, Lord knows, careful what you ask for, right? But I just have this vision of me made up as a bride, and in just enjoying that bride, and I have a groom, a male, and for this other person who doesn't believe in it, I wonder what they're gonna see, and then I would hope that if this individual, dead names me or something. I almost hope my husband punches him or something. You know what I mean? It's like, How dare you insult my wife? You know, again, someone, you know, our white knight who's going to stand up for us, even though we can stand up for ourselves. But you know what I mean. You know, there's a part of me that's like, not vindictive or spiteful, but, you know, what will this person do when they're the only person who believes that way? You know, and again, when I was in my 20s, there was multiple people who believed that way. There were more people who disagreed or disbelieved than believed. And now it's the reverse. And again, I think that's part of that transition, especially when we're starting out. You know, we're thinking about it. We want to start hormones, et cetera, et cetera. And we're so afraid as to what our family is going to do or our friends or our coworkers. You know, and so that fear, shame, and guilt does a number on us. And we listen to the naysayers, you know, who say, this isn't possible. It's against the will of God. You'll be an ugly woman, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Well, nevertheless, she persisted. Nevertheless, we do it. And a year or two later, the hormones have had a chance to work. Our outward appearance has changed a little bit. Our inward appearance, our, you know, our neural networks have been rebuilt. And our inner, what I would call our feminine energy, is projected around us. And so the people who doubt are in the minority, whereas before they were in the majority, right? And so, you know, they can't, especially nowadays, I don't think, you know, granted now I'm thinking of Facebook as being an echo chamber and the people we keep around us as being somewhat of an echo chamber. But again, I would hope at my marriage ceremony or my hand fasting, depending on what happens, you know, you're going to have one or two people who might be disbelievers in a room full of people who believe or who accept me for who I am. And at that point, the tables have flipped. You know, they're in the minority. And we can hope maybe they'll change their mind or whatnot. But again, if they don't believe in it. So your mileage may vary. My mileage may vary. And this journey isn't over yet. I'm not done growing. I'm not done changing. I'm not done. But it did strike me out today, like I said. So. All right, my friends, I do apologize for the long video, maybe because I haven't made one in a couple days. This one's a little longer to make up for it. Takeaways, again, especially I know when we start out, we have doubt and fear and, you know, well, what if so-and-so doesn't accept it? And I know in my experience, that is a tiny bit in the negative scale. But in the positive scale, so much more, so positive and so affirming. And I mean, this to me is my reality. This is where I put my energy and whatnot. Not in trying to appease someone else's perception of me, their attempt to control me now. We don't put energy in that. It's like the old thing, you inside of you, you have two dogs and whichever one you feed more eventually eats the other one, you know. So I would rather focus my energy on this call, this scale over here. So, all right, my friends, till next time, good luck to you in your journey, and definitely good luck in becoming the best version of yourself that you want to be as you define it. Okay, until next time, good luck.